Thank you all for coming here. So, and now I'll say a bit about our speaker here today. And most of you know something about him, so it might be repetitive, but here goes. So Dr. Eric Mazur is currently the Balkansky Professor of Physics and Applied Physics at Harvard University. He's the Area Dean in Applied Physics. He completed his PhD at Leiden University in Netherlands, and then he first came to Harvard as a postdoc and then a faculty position, and he ran through the ranks so fast he made it here, right? And he's an accomplished scholar in optical physics. He's published more than 200 articles. He's served on various committees, for example, the National Science Foundation, as you'd expect. He's a recipient of numerous prestigious awards and honors, including honorary degrees and honorary professorships. He's also a committed and effective teacher. And really, that's the reason we've got him here. He is rightly famous for developing a method of for teaching large lecture classes interactively and effectively. So his methods have been adopted by educators and disciplines in many different disciplines and in many countries. If you ever look at his webpage and see his travel schedule, you'll wonder how he does it. he does. And those who want to learn more about the method after today's workshops, you can obviously look at the recording that John's going to make, but you can also look online at YouTube, or you can buy the book, Peer Instruction, A User's Manual. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Eric Mazur.
Thank you, Brad. That was somewhat of a surprise. I thought I was here to talk about nanophotonics. I should have known. You never get a full house like this. You talk about nanophotonics. Anyway, I'm kind of nervous, you know. You must all like public confessions. I'd rather do this one-on-one instead of in front of so many people. I guess I have to remind myself of the American proverb, the more you confess, the more books you will sell. Anyway, so let's get started. First confession. When I started teaching at Harvard University in, almost 30 years ago, 1984, I never asked myself the question, how am I going to teach? That was kind of strange, because when you start doing something new in your career, that should be the first question that comes up in your mind. It was completely clear to me what I was going to do. I was going to do to my students what my instructors had done to me, lecturers, I'm doing now to you right here in this room. And to make matters worse, very quickly, I was receiving signs that I was doing the right thing. See, as an assistant professor, I was asked to teach a course that none of my colleagues wanted to teach. Physics for pre-medical students. These were not students who wanted to learn physics. No, they had physics already before setting foot into my classroom. And most of my colleagues, when they taught that course, we come close to committing suicide at the end of the term. Because they weren't very kind. The students weren't very kind to my colleagues. But not so for me. I got a 4.5 or a 4.8 on a 5-point scale, so clearly the students liked what I was doing in the classroom. So that's one metric by which we tend to evaluate the quality of teaching. I can think of another one. The performance of students on exams. We'll talk more about that in my second talk. You know, even though most physics for pre-med courses are algebra-based, at Harvard we teach them a full-blown calculus-based course. And I could give these students some exam problems that I wasn't sure I would do well on under the pressure of an exam. But, you know, by and large, I did well. So they liked me as an instructor. They did well on what I considered to be really difficult problems. Very quickly, I started to believe that I was the world's best physics teacher. And that illusion, because it turned out to be a complete illusion, went on for many, many years. in spite of the fact that there were always some negative signs. But you know, I'm a positive thinker, so if I get positive signs and negative signs, I ignore the negative ones and focus on the positive ones. Let me give you some examples. Every year, in spite of giving me high ratings on my end of semester questionnaire, some students would write in the comment section, "Physics is boring," or "Physics sucks." I could never make any sense of that. I mean, what is more interesting than understanding how the world around you works? So it didn't make any sense to me, and I therefore ignored them. Same thing when I go to a party and people ask me what I do for a living, and I tell them, "I'm a physicist." "Oh, physics. I had such a hard time with physics in high school or in college." "Oh, my dentist recently told me," and I couldn't even talk back because, you know, I had a thing in my mouth. He said, "You're a physicist." "I got an A for physics in college, but I really didn't understand anything." It always creates this feeling of embarrassment, and I never really understood where these remarks were coming from. I think I'll shed some light on that today. Okay, so you all have a little clicker, and it's dangerous to start a talk with technology, because I do not want to give the impression that this is a talk about technology. It is not. Everything I'm going to tell you today, you can do without technology. I love technology. I have all the latest gadgets, you know, in my pockets and in my briefcase. In fact, I recently got Google Glass. I don't know why, but I thought I had to get that too to see how it works. But I'm a big skeptic when it comes to technology and education. I think if you look back, technology has done very little for education. And mostly it's because most users of technology in education are simply old wine into new bottles. The only justified way for technology really would be to use it to afford a new mode of learning, to make something possible that is not possible before. However, I would argue that 99.9% of everything that is done in education is, in terms of technology, is simply a new way of doing an old thing. And therefore, you know, we shouldn't be too surprised that not much is happening. It's the pedagogy that matters. This talk is about pedagogy. That being said, I'm going to use the clickers to poll you in the beginning, not to use them as an educational tool at all, just to poll you. And unfortunately, that's the way most people use it. Then later, towards the end of my talk, I'm going to model peer instruction. I'm going to show you how you could use clickers to actually reawaken the curiosity of the human mind. Okay, so that comes later. So let me first show to you how they work. There's no on-off button, because I noticed that you have a slightly different type of clicker on campus here. There's no on-off button. Click. If you change your mind, if you press, let's say, 3, and then think, "Oh no, I should have pressed 5, that's no problem, just press 5. That doesn't mean you get to vote twice. No, the 5 overrides the 3. And the little window here shows the button you have pressed. If you see a confirmation there, you know that your vote has been counted and received. Let me show you what I see. My software consists of this tiny little window that floats in front of my presentation software. Regardless of what it is, I actually happen to like Acrobat as presentation software. It's independent of whatever you use in class, whether it's a Word document or PowerPoint or Keynote or you name it, it's independent of it. There's a little counter. Let me zoom in so you can see it. As you can see, 14 of you have already been playing with their clickers. That's quite all right. Why don't you press and notice how the number is. Very good. I can, I have a start and stop button here, and I can blow up the window, make it large, but it's still small, so it doesn't hide anything behind. And the buttons beneath allow me to do several things, like display this distribution. Why don't you all press 1 now? Go ahead, press 1. And notice how instantly, I love it when audiences follow my instruction. Notice how the distribution at once changes, replacing the old rows with the new one. If I hit stop here, it freezes this distribution. Now, if you press a button, you don't see the number that you press, but you see a circle with a line saying polling is closed. And so you can no longer, if you were to all press 5 now, it would not change the distribution. That's all there is to it, and I think it's important because, you know, when you're in front of
the classroom, apparently the sound of the bat is...
The sound?
Yeah.
It is? So, that's all there is to it. Now, when I hit the stop button, one more thing's happened. Not only does it store these data, it takes a picture on what's on the screen behind. This way, later when I review the data, I can see what I had on the screen when I polled my audience. That means I don't have to program anything, nothing. Right? It's all, as long as I have my slides ready, I can always use the software. Turn the clicker around. Turn the clicker around. And notice that on the back, there's a barcode. Each clicker has a unique ID number, so you may think, you know, you're sitting here anonymously. I'm sorry. Yeah. Each time you press a button and we carefully place the clicker. Okay, enough about technology, because again, this is not about technology, and I don't want to put the emphasis on technology at all, but now you know how to use that. This first talk is really about education. And I think the best way to start a conversation, because I want this to turn into a conversation, about education is by making you reflect on your own education. And I'm going to give you a little exercise, and for that exercise I want you to pull out a little piece of paper, or something to write on, it could be your computer or your smartphone. And I'm going to ask you a very personal question. But you will not have to reveal. You've got to write down the answer to this very personal question on that piece of paper. But you will not have to reveal it to anyone. So as soon as you write it down, fold it over so nobody can read what you wrote down. Okay? So here's the question. Think of something you're good at. Something you know you do well. Something you're proud of. Something other people respect you for. And ideally, I want you to choose something that has been important in your career. No, it could be anything. It could be solving partial differential equations. It could be interpreting medieval works of art. It could be photography, baking cakes, and so on. But, you know, I don't think we have any photographers or bakers here, so.
There are some art faculty.
There are some art faculty. Okay, yeah. Perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
It was to cook you do.
So. You know what I mean, write it down. Usually when I do this in an academic environment, within a few seconds, somebody raises their hand and says, only one thing? Yeah, only one thing. There are still some seats here in the front.
Five of the seats down here.
Okay, so anybody need more time? No, you're all successful people, I know, so. Okay, so now you can hide it. The only reason I had you write it down was because my second question refers to the answer we wrote down. The second question is hard. How did you become good at whatever it is that you wrote down? Where did you develop that skill or knowledge? What did you do to become good at it? You know, when I asked the first question, everybody immediately started writing. Second question, people are just there. And the reason is because when we're good at something, we tend to enjoy it, we take ownership of it. We become unaware of the learning process. So, think back into your past, and in a few words, write down what you did to become good at whatever it is you wrote down. By the way, I've done this little exercise all over the world. I've done it from Patagonia in Chile to Colombia to Central America, all over the US, Alaska. I've done it throughout Europe. I've done it throughout Asia, Malaysia, Thailand, Japan, Korea, China, Taiwan. I've done it in several parts of the African continent, South Africa, Egypt, in the Middle East, Saudi Arabia, Jordan. And you know, there's something really interesting. The answers to the second question, which I have collected on some occasions, I won't today because we have those trackers, do not differ from one culture to the next. In other words, the Chinese will respond the same way the Chileans do, and so on. And maybe that's not that surprising, right? Because we're all human beings, and we're all wired to learn in the same way. But I've never done this in Oswego, New York, so who knows? Maybe you are different. Does anybody need more time for the second question? Okay. So let's actually use the clickers for this. When I survey people, this is typically where the responses fall in. I became good at it by trial and error, by trying things and then making mistakes and then learning from my mistakes. I became good at it by listening to lectures. The word listening is not on there. But as we all know, giving lectures is something very different from listening to lectures. In fact, I think I've taught myself quite a few things by taking on a course where I wanted to learn the material. So that's not what I mean by two. Three, I became good at it by practicing. Four, I became good at it through apprenticeship, by tagging along with somebody really, really good, and then learning from that person. And then five is sort of a mishmash of other categories, like friends, family, and so on. So choose whichever of those five comes closest to what you wrote down, and then we'll see if you are any different from the rest of the world. Let's see, how many do we have here? 61, 62. I'm going to give you 5 more seconds. 5, 3.
There's 89 and I'm holed out.
Okay. It's not that hard, you know. Okay, so let's see where we are. And no, you're no different from the rest of the world. Typically between 50% and 70% chooses practice. We learn by doing. So you can relax, you're no different from humans anywhere else on the planet. But this is not why I did this little exercise. There's something else rather peculiar about this distribution here. What is it? Lectures. Nobody chose lectures. And how do we teach? This is how we teach. So you've just, this is actually a picture, this is a very old picture of me teaching. It was taken BC. Before computers. See, I'm still using an overhead projector there. Anyway, so you've just admitted that something that was important in your career, you learned it by doing, not by listening to lectures. Yeah, this is how we teach. You see right off the bat here something interesting, right? Our teaching practices are not aligned with the way we learn. You know, typically there's one or two poor souls who choose lectures. Absolutely nobody. So in that respect, you're actually different from the rest of the world, because usually it's 1% or 2% of the time. So this is what I like to do. I like to start by talking a bit more about education. What is education? What do we mean when we use the word education? We're educators, so we should know what we mean. But imagine that I asked you to write down a short definition of the word education. I bet a lot of you would be struggling. Me too. We know what we mean, but to articulate it, it's not that easy. But we're educators. So we ought to know what we mean when we use the word education. I'd like to talk briefly about reinstruction, which is a technique that I developed when I discovered that, after all, I wasn't the world's best physics teacher. In fact, my students were learning next to nothing in my highly rated classes. And in spite of them being able to do, you know, standard textbook problems, they had not even understood the most basic principle in physics. I'll tell you more about that in just a second. And then lastly, since we're in an academic environment, I thought we'd end with a test just before the coffee break. So you better pay attention. So let's start by talking about education. And given that lectures are so pervasive, if I look at the architecture of this classroom, a brand new building, and you know, this whole architecture just screams lecture. Let's ask ourselves the question, what is it that happens in a lecture? Take this picture of me teaching my pre-med course a long, long time ago in the Science Center at Harvard. I would like you to describe to me in one or two words the process that is happening on the screen behind me. And ideally, I want to hear verbs. But the two verbs I do not want to hear are teaching and learning. So you have to come up with other words. So go ahead, just blurt it out.
Transcribing.
That's actually very interesting because I once heard somebody describe the lecture as a process whereby the lecture notes of the instructor get transferred to the notebook of the students without passing through the brains of either. And before Gutenberg, that was definitely one of the main purposes of the lecture. The word lecture comes from the Latin verb to read. In fact, in the UK, an academic rank is called reader. So we're all, in a sense, readers. So let's hear some others.
Entertaining.
Thank you. It's a picture. Yes.
Listening.
Imparting.
Explaining.
Demonstrating.
Demonstrating.
Yes. What else?
Transferring information.
You know, usually there's somebody who says...
Repeating.
Problem solving.
Sleeping.
I told you this was a picture of my class. Thank you very much. But now that you say that, I can't resist quoting Albert Camus once said, some people talk in their sleep. Lecturers talk while other people are sleeping. And you know what? At the end of my talk, I'm going to show you some data from MIT that shows, very exciting data, very recent data, that shows that this is often close to the truth. You will see that's at the end. So, you know, these are my students, and you can see their necks are all straight, so they're not sleeping. Now, notice that most of the things that we heard pertain either to me or the students, listening, writing, and so on. There were two things that we heard that encapsulated the whole process. One is transcribing, and the other is, Brad, you must have heard this talk before, so you gave it away. Transferring information. Lectures focus on the transfer of information. Some people sometimes say knowledge, but I don't know how to translate knowledge. Knowledge is something that needs to be constructed in the brain of the learner. The only thing I can really transmit is information. And you know what? My students had rubbed that in my face very early in my teaching career, and I had ignored it. Not only had I ignored it, I've gotten kind of upset. See, I told you earlier at the beginning of my talk that I didn't ask myself how I was going to teach. What do you think was the question that did come up in my mind when I started teaching? What, or precisely what book? So I went to a colleague who had taught the course before, and he said, oh, in this course we have used Halliday and Resnick. It's been a classic book for something like 50 years. It's actually still in print and being used. And I was told that in the U.S., because as you heard, I was educated in Europe, I was told that in the U.S., students bought the textbook, and I had to make sure that there were sufficient textbooks in stock in the bookstore. So I went to the Harvard Coop, which is our bookstore in Harvard Square, and I said, be sure that by September 15th, you have enough copies of Halliday and Resnick in store. And as I walked back to my office, I said to myself, wait a minute, if the students have the textbook, and I have the same textbook, then what do I do in the classroom? So I stopped at my colleague's office again, and I asked him this question. He said, oh, don't worry, there are lots of different physics textbooks, and he showed me a shelf full. And I looked around, and very quickly I found the perfect textbook. It was perfect for two reasons. One, it was different from how that resonates, so at least I was not regurgitating the content of the book that the students had bought. But that was not the main reason. The main reason that this was the perfect book was that it was out of print. The students couldn't get their hands on it anymore. Now, in class, I projected my notes, or I wrote them on the board. And because the book that the students had bought was different from the notes I took from, I thought, you know what, by the end of class, I distribute copies of my notes. And this was before the internet, way before the internet, so the best I could do was giving photocopies away. So as they walked out of class, and there were doors in the back, just like here, they could pick up a copy of the notes. Now, why do you think that I hand them out at the end of class?
They could listen.
So they would listen. But isn't that already admitting that there's something wrong? I mean, why force them to get the information out of my mouth if they could get the same information out of my notes? Well, that question never came up in my mind. But what did happen was that at the end of that first term, in spite of giving me high ratings on my end of semester evaluations, about half a dozen students wrote, "Professor Mazur is lecturing straight from his lecture notes." Hello? What was I supposed to do? Develop another set of lecture notes to lecture from that was different from the lecture notes I had. These ungrateful students. But you know, the students had a point. And if they would have read the book, they would have seen that the information in the book wasn't that different from that in the lecture notes. So, given that this approach to teaching is taking place all around the world, right? I mean, I'm sure that if we were to step into some random classrooms here, we'd see a scene that is not very different from the one on there. In fact, now look at the architecture of this room, as I said earlier. One could well ask the question, is that what education is? Is education merely the transfer of information? Actually, let's have a quick poll here. So, you know, just to have you participate. So, let me, why isn't it? There we go. So press 1 if you agree with the statement, education is just the transfer of information. Press 2 if you think education is more than just the transfer of information. Go ahead. 5 more seconds left. And let's see where we stand on this issue. Okay. Pretty unanimous. There are a few poor souls who think that education is just the transfer of information. I have a warning for those of you who pressed 1. You are about to lose your job. Because, let's be very pragmatic. Suppose for a moment that education is just the transfer of information. Let's assume that. What would be the logical thing to do in the 21st century?
Make it as cheap as possible.
I can't hear.
Make it as cheap as possible.
Make it?
As cheap.
As cheap as possible. But how would you do that?
Give them the web address.
Give them the web address. Just film the best possible instructor for physics, for Spanish, for art, for you name it, and put it online. Do that for English and Chinese and different languages, and put it online. What would you lose by doing that? Of course, we lose our jobs, but in addition to that, what would we lose? Interaction. But let's face it, how much interaction is there really in a classroom like this? I'm trying to work really hard to be frank with you. In a standard classroom, there's hardly any interaction. I make a habit of observing on my campus and on campuses I visit classes. Drop in on a psychology class, Steven Pinker lecturing, brilliant lectures, you know, a lot of great lectures. And then after a few minutes, the lecturer stops and says, "Does anybody have a question? Anybody?" And the students look down because they don't want to make eye contact. And if the instructor waits long enough, it's always the same person in the front row. Most of the students do not want to interact. In part, it's because of this architecture. Who developed this architecture? No, not
church. It's medieval.
Not the church either.
It's medieval.
It's older than medieval.
Greek. Greek.
The ancient Greek, exactly. Why did the ancient Greek develop this document?
Theater.
Theater, so that everybody could see and hear the performance. As soon as you sit down in a seat like this one right here, when you sat down before listening to me, you immediately turned into a passive role. You sat down thinking, I'm going to observe and listen, not I'm going to participate. It puts you immediately into a passive role. In fact, did the Greek use the amphitheater as a learning space?
Not so.
No, if you look at an illustration of the school of Athens, you see people talking and walking in pair, discussing. Somewhere in the Middle Ages, we adopted the performance space as a learning space. And, you know, putting all the focus on the teacher. So I think there's very little interaction. When you go to a concert, you've got to be quiet, right? So this puts you in a passive role. There's very little interaction, so you wouldn't lose any interaction. You would lose your job. On top of that, I think by putting it online, if information is, if education is just transferred to the paper, we gain something. Because you produce the opportunity to think. You see, in a lecture, your brain is held captive by the presenter who is speaking. You can't think. Well, you can think very superficially, but you cannot think deeply. Have you ever had a student in your class raise his or her hand and say, Professor, could you please be quiet for 5 minutes? I need to think. It's never happened. But you know, you either think or you listen. Our brains are not made to multitask. If you think, your mind is wandering and you're no longer listening to the incoming information. Have you ever had a student who, online you could easily do that, right? Because you could pause a video and think. When you read a book, you do that automatically. You regulate the pace at which the information comes in. If you don't understand something, you pause, you stop reading, and you think. But in a lecture, you can't do that. Likewise, you can listen to something again, which you can't do in a lecture, unless you raise your hand and say, Professor, could you please repeat the last 20 minutes? I need to hear it again, which again, I don't think happens very often. So my point, if education is just a transfer of information, we're all going to lose our jobs. Luckily, I think 96% of you, and I'm one of them, believe that education is more than just a transfer of information. So let me now pick on, enough picking on those 4%, on the rest of you. What more than the transfer of information is education? Yes?
Well, it's an acquisition of knowledge that you can apply to a variety of contexts.
An acquisition of knowledge that you can apply in a variety of contexts. Let's hear some more.
Inspiring.
Inspiring can be done in a lecture. I've watched quite a few TED lectures that I think are extremely inspiring and that push me to discover more. So I think that can be done in a lecture. Yes?
Getting feedback on your work.
Getting feedback on your work. How much feedback am I getting now? I don't know. I mean, I would say assessment is perhaps feedback, which we're going to talk about in about half an hour. Let's hear some more.
Lab work.
Lab work. But not in a classroom like this, right?
Development of skills that can be applied in an authentic environment.
Development of skills that can be applied in an authentic environment. Think about the little exercise we started with.
Practice.
You got to do something with that knowledge. It's not enough just, you know, to open your skull, put the information, I should say, not knowledge. It's not enough to open your skull, put the information in, and close your skull. However, so much of education is instructors delivering information to the students, and then you wait a month or maybe a few weeks. You isolate the students from any source of information, and you have them regurgitate that same information back to you. As you heard, I was educated in Europe. We tend to pride ourselves in high quality education, secondary education in Europe. But if I look back, it was all a house of cards. I mean, take history. I was educated both in Holland and in France. In Holland, the emphasis was on Dutch history. In France, the emphasis was on French history. At some point, in history class in Holland, I learned that in 1660-something, I forgot, I'm sorry, somebody can Google it, the Dutch defeated the British in the River Thames, just outside London. And then a few weeks later on the exam, in what year did the Dutch defeat the British in the River Thames? I must have remembered it long enough to pass the exam, but you know, frankly, I've forgotten. In fact, I don't even know why the Dutch were fighting the British, or how they managed to sail up the River Thames and defeat the British Navy there. Did it make me, you know, a better citizen by knowing, by remembering that date for a few weeks or maybe a month? I don't think so. But it's a sad truth that that is the emphasis of a lot of education and assessment. I think it was Einstein who once said, education is what is left after all that is learned is forgotten. Very sad statement, actually. So the key point is not the transfer of information. The key point is making sense of this information, having this aha moment, oh, I get it. Ask yourself, where did that aha moment, I ask myself the same question often, where did the aha moment occur for me? Did it happen while I was sitting in a classroom not very different from this, listening to my professors? I don't think so. It happened mostly outside of the classroom. When I went over my notes, when I thought, I gotta figure this out, and then maybe I'd ask some friends for help, and I went, oh, yes, and it stuck. Anyway, as I told you, for many, many years, I thought I was the world's best physics teacher. And then one day, I read an article that claimed that students don't learn any physics in their introductory physics classes, non-majors. And the article came with a test called the Force Concept Inventory that tests students' basic understanding of the concept of force. Now, at Harvard, most of my students have had AP, and they have a 5 on the AP. They're kind of upset that we ignore AP credits, so that they still have to take a physics course. So, you know, I basically gloss over force early in the term and immediately launch into other concepts that depend on the concept of force. And this test claimed that it didn't make much difference whether you tested students at the beginning of an introductory physics course or at the end. I thought, no way. If not my students, not Harvard students. But I'm a scientist, so one of the things you learn as a scientist is you don't make assertions, you actually get data. So I thought, I'm going to give it to my students. As soon as they started taking this test, I tumbled out of my ivory tower, because within minutes, one student raised her hand, and she said, Professor Mazur, how should I answer these questions? According to what you taught us, or according to the way I usually think about these things? I had no idea how to answer that question. And by the time the test had been completed, I had, you know, tumbled out of my tower, as I said. I would love to share the data with you, but I have to give you that little test at the end. So I'm unfortunately not able to show you the data, but the data is on my website, and on YouTube, there's a version of this talk that has the data. So you may want to look there. So in spite of my high end of semester evaluation, in spite of my students being able to solve textbook problems, they had not even internalized the most basic principle in physics. How did they manage to solve the textbook problem? That really surprised me. Simply by doing it by rote, by applying a procedure that they had memorized, without really understanding the reasons for the procedure. Not only is there lack of learning, there's lack of retention. And as I said already, you know, this quote by Einstein, we tend to forget everything we've learned. In fact, if I look back at most of my education, you know, I've forgotten probably most of it. As somebody who's active in nanophotonics right now, I had to teach the whole field of nanophotonics, I had to teach myself after graduating, because even in graduate school, that field did not exist. We're preparing our students for futures that we cannot even imagine. When I was a student, if you would have said, I need a web programmer, I would have had no clue what you were talking about, because the web did not exist. And I think the same will be true for our students. So we need to prepare our students for a future that's very different from the present. So it's not the transfer of information that matters, but the assimilation. And if we think about education, we can see there's a two-step process. I think we all agree you need to have a transfer of information. No transfer of information, no education. But that's not enough. There's a second step. The students, the learners, need to make sense of that information. Need to be able to extract the knowledge, the mental models that can be applied in a different context. As we heard before, you know, it's not just applying in the same context, it's applying into a new context that matters. In the standard approach to education, the emphasis in class is on one, whereas two, which I would argue is the harder part, is left to the students on their own outside of class. Back then, in 1990, when I first discovered this, I thought, you know, I should really do this the other way around. I should focus on the second step, not on the first step. And instead of doing one in class and leaving two to the students out of class, I should flip this around and ask the students to read my notes before coming to class so that in class I can help them assimilate the information. And what I ended up doing in class, I don't want to talk about one. To me, one is the trivial part of education, and there's so much discussion about how to transfer the information outside of class. I want to talk about two. What do you do in the class if your students have acquired the information, or maybe not acquired, been exposed to the information outside of the class? And what I do in class was actually the result of a totally serendipitous discovery. You see, on this force concept inventory, this test that I referred to earlier, one of the questions is this. A heavy truck and a light car collide head-on on the highway. Is the force exerted by the heavy truck on the light car larger than that of the light car on the heavy truck? They're equal to each other, second choice. Three, the light car exerts a larger force on the heavy truck than the other way around. D, they're not exerting any force on each other, they're just in each other's way. You're laughing about that. I think no physicist would ever come up with such a crazy answer. And that's the problem with multiple choice tests, right? Because we all suffer from what my colleague Steven Pinker calls the curse of knowledge. If you know the answer, it's easy to come up with the right answer, but hard to come up with incorrect reasonings. The way the author of the force concept inventory, David Hestanis at Arizona State University, developed the choices was by first giving all of these questions as open-ended questions to the students and then tabulating the most frequent incorrect responses. Now, most students in physics can recite Newton's third law by heart. You may have heard about it. Action is reaction, or the force of object one on object two is equal to the force exerted by object two on object one. An equation, F12 equals F21. Now something really interesting happens when you replace one by heavy truck and two by light car. Because in spite of them reciting Newton's law, they all are convinced that the heavy truck exerts a larger force on the light car than the other way around. Anyway, in class, after they took this test, not only was I shocked, the students were just as shocked. They had a midterm coming up, and then the final, and you know, they thought it was an easy test, and now they saw that they had scored poorly on it. So they asked me for a session to go over every single question on the FCI. When I got to this question about the truck and the car, I made a drawing of the truck on one side of the board, car on the other. I drew the force of gravity, the other forces, the force of the truck on the car on the truck, and I said, by Newton's third law, these two are equal. What else is there to explain about it? And I turned around, and I could see at once that they were confused. So I said, is there a question? They were so confused they could not articulate the question. So I thought, this is serious. So I,
let me try it again. So I erased the board. This time I brought in, equations. I wrote it down in equation form. I brought in Newton's second law. I worked out the acceleration. I mean, in 8 minutes, I gave the most brilliant explanation you could possibly imagine. I was so proud that in 8 minutes I stood with my back to them for 8 minutes. I turned around and my coat jacket covered in chalk dust. They looked even more confused. And they could still not articulate a coherent question. I didn't know how to explain it in any other way. I knew one thing though. I knew that half of them had given the right answer on the test. So in a moment of despair, I said to them, why don't you discuss it with each other? I had 250 students in the classroom, and something happened I'd never seen before. Complete chaos. They all started talking to each other. They forgot about me in front of the class. I mean, I could have walked away. They would not have noticed it. And what's more, in just 2 minutes, they figured it out. I thought, how can it be? I, the expert, tries for 10 minutes in two different ways to explain it to them, and they don't get it, and in just 2 minutes they figure it out. But imagine you have two students sitting next to each other, John and Mary. Mary has the right answer because she understands it, John does not. On average, Mary is more, I won't say that it always works, but on average, Mary is more likely to convince John because she has the right logic. But that's not the important point. The important point is Mary is more likely to convince John than Professor Mazur in front of the class. Why? Because she has only recently learned it. She still knows what the difficulties are that the beginning learner has. Whereas Professor Mazur learned it such a long time ago. To him it is so clear that he cannot even understand why somebody doesn't understand it. It's again this curse of knowledge. So I thought I gotta bring this into practice in the classroom more often. So now rather than teaching by telling, I teach by questioning. By the way, this is nothing new. Who said that the first time? Socrates. Now here we're in the 21st century, I'm still mostly teaching by telling. So I walk into class, I talk a few minutes, I put a question on the screen. I give students time to think. It's silent. I do not want them to talk to anyone. Silent, okay? And then after 2 minutes, I ask them to vote. Initially with it was hands on the chest. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? So I ask all the students to put their hands on the chest at the same time, using their fingers to indicate their choice. Does this mean that as a teacher you see the distribution, but the students do not see the distribution? And I tell them all at the same time, if there's a student who does not put his or her hand on the chest, I'll ask the student to stand up and tell everybody what their choice are. They quickly put their hand on their chest. And then if you want to reveal the choice, you ask them to raise their hand all at the same time, showing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I mean, the great thing about the clicker is you get the data. With fingers, you only get a qualitative sense. But it works just as well. In fact, the clicker started because my book appeared on peer instruction, and there was a need for a device to quickly tell the students. So I call them, and then I tell the students, find a neighbor who has a different answer and try to convince that neighbor of your answer. By the way, it's very important to say it this way because students will happily talk to a neighbor who has the same answer and not learn anything. I tell them, find somebody. So if you turn to your left and the person on your left has the same answer, you say, thank you very much, and you turn to the person on your right. And if they convince the person on the right or the person on the right convinces them, they shouldn't just go and sit there. No, they have to find somebody else. It continues. And I tell them it's fine to walk around in the classroom. This will hold for you too when you do it. If I see you without talking to anybody, I will come and talk to you. That will hold for you too, by the way. So trust me, students rather talk to friends than to me. So okay. Then I call them again, and if the initial poll, the one here, is between 30 and 70%, or 35 and 70%, then typically the number of correct answers will increase dramatically.
If it's less than 35%, there are not enough students to spread the right mental model. I typically abort the question. If there's more than 70%, they're going to have trouble finding someone who has a different answer. So the best questions are those that initially yield between 35 and 70% correct answers. And then we end with an explanation, which can be either provided by me or by the students, ideally by the students. And then the cycle repeats until class time is up. And of course, the learning takes place right here during that discussion. Let me show you a little video.
So we have a rectangular loop that is placed in a uniform magnetic field in the direction indicated by these arrows. So the question is, what are the magnetic forces on the four different sides of this loop? So take a minute to think about this.
No, this is not going to be on the test, by the way, so don't worry, okay? They think, I typically give them about 2 minutes.
Answers.
I see the distribution, but they do not. I do not show this distribution.
So turn to your neighbor and see if you can convince one another of the correct choice. Initially, we had sort of an even split. And now we have an absolutely overwhelming majority for choice number two.
The bottom of this loop is pulled towards you. The top is okay. Pulled away.
So, let me turn the volume up again. We need to find a way to adjust the volume later on.
Okay. So what's going on here? It's active, not passive. It is impossible to sleep through our classes because every few minutes, your neighbor will start talking to you.
Believe it or not, some students actually complain about that. They'd rather be knitting or checking their computers or sleeping.
The other thing, it's a two-way flow of information. It's not just information from me to the students, information coming back. If they don't understand something, I see it then and there. Lastly, it's continuous formative assessment. They get to try out their knowledge. Without penalty, because I don't give any credit or points. And our faculty members give points for clicker participation. I think that's a bad idea, because the only thing guaranteed is that your students' bodies will be here. You want their minds here. In fact, if you look on Twitter for class and clicker, it's hilarious. You'll see some students post pictures of them sitting in class with four clickers, clicking for their friends, or some students who just tweet. Professor just asked a clicker question. I'm going home now because I can't. That's the only reason for them for coming to class, not for the learning. So, but if you use it as purely formative assessment, they get to try out. If you are still getting it wrong on the second try, and you see that 90% of your classmates have it right, you go, oh, I better look at it. You want to try it? Good. Did you all read those two paragraphs about thermal expansion that I asked Brad to distribute to you? No? Brad.
I know, they're very naughty.
I'm kidding. But you know what that means? That means I will need to lecture you briefly on thermal expansion. I'm actually very grateful for that, because the one thing I miss after having implemented peer structure is lecturing. So. Thermal expansion has to deal with the fact that solids, hard solids, expand when it gets hotter, and then they shrink again when it gets colder. In engineering, it's very important. For example, you may have been in a train at low speed and notice that you hear this clickety-clack sound of the wheels as they go over the gaps between different sections of the rail. The reason they leave that gap is so that when it gets hotter, the rail can expand, and if it doesn't have that space, bad things happen. There's a railroad in India that started to buckle and then the train derailed. Steel beam buildings, I'm sure this is one of them because it's a modern building, you need to take into account the considerable expansion and then shrinkage of the steel. Otherwise, you know, you get cracked plaster and other problems. Next time you park your car in a concrete parking structure, look down and you'll notice that every 30 yards or so, there's a rubber strip. The The reason is they leave gaps between sections of the concrete, because concrete too, like steel, not as much, but also expand, and if you don't have that space to expand, bad things happen. So it's an important process in engineering. And the reason thermal expansion takes place is that any solid is made up from, any material actually, solids too, are made up from atoms, and atoms get further away from each other when it gets hotter. So this is cold, and this is hot. Cold and hot. This is all I'm going to test you on. But you know, you may wonder, why is it that they get further away from each other? So just to satisfy your curiosity, the reason is that atoms don't sit still, they vibrate. And the amplitude of that vibration is what we call temperature. So this is cold, this is hot. Cold, hot. Now, as you vibrate over a larger amplitude, you need more space. So you push all of the atoms around you away. Cold and hot. Questions, anyone? Oh, good. Yes.
Does water expand when it's...
So doesn't water expand when it solidifies? Yes, but that's a transition between liquid and solid. If you take ice and you cool it down, it shrinks. And if you heat it up, it expands again. Then if you heat it up enough so that it melts, strange things happen. But we won't be talking about that. Because ice cube floats, you're totally right. Yes, you have it.
But railroads are using continuous welded rail now.
They are. And in fact, with some continuous welded rails, there are occasionally trouble. Like, for example, during the Olympics in London, that was in the summer, it was really hot. They had to shut down the high-speed railroad because there was not enough. They use other ways of absorbing the expansion, and it was not enough. So.
So you're saying the thermal expansion is all the result of the atoms moving?
All of the atoms get further away from each other.
If the atoms didn't move, then this was a non-issue.
If the atoms were all sitting still like
sitting
this,
like this.
Yeah. But their motion is what we call temperature. So when you touch something that's hot, you basically get energy transferred by the vigorous shaking of the atoms inside the material. Yeah. Cold? You're way beyond what I knew I was a good lecturer, so yeah. Yes?
Using this as a metaphor in regards to education, the expansion of ideas more beneficial in a one-on-one situation with a student versus your confession at the beginning of being nervous, you know, with a large lecture hall. So the question being expanding the student's horizons within a one-on-one conference.
Well, I'm not 100% sure about the metaphor, but I totally agree with you, you know, that one-on-one is a very effective way of teaching. In fact, I'm going to show you that this is a way of doing one-on-one all at once. One-on-one is good because you have a dialogue. It's not a lecture. One-on-one, you would never lecture. You'd get pretty upset at me if I were just, you know, we sit together somewhere and I keep talking and talking and talking and talking and talking. You need to have the time to think nor to interject anything. It'd be back and forth and an exchange of ideas rather than just a lecture. So what I'm going to show you is that you can turn a classroom, even with 300 people, into a dialogue, one-on-one, all at once. Okay, but we're drifting here from the subject of my talk. So, of my question, pardon me. So, hot and cold.
What?
Oops, pardon me. Hot and cold. Oh, by the way, it's not just those nine atoms, right? It's all of them, the millions and billions of atoms that make up a piece of material. I think you're ready for the question. Yeah? Okay, good. So no talking to each other. No talking to each other until I tell you. If you talk before I tell you, I'm going to ask you to stand up and tell the entire room what you just told your neighbor. All right. Okay, so consider a rectangular metal plate with a circular hole in it. When the plate is uniformly heated, what happens to the diameter of the hole? Will it increase? Will it stay the same? Or will it, hey, wait, I haven't even read the question. Or will it decrease? So for the smart people who have already answered, 15 of them, you know, you gotta think. Because I'm not simply gonna ask you to regurgitate what I just told you. You gotta think this, put this in a different context. So, hey, who was talking there?
I pressed the wrong number and she just told me I did it again.
You are not supposed to know what the this person. That's called cheating.
How much time do we get?
You're gonna get another 30 seconds. So if you already answered, ask yourself, how am I going to convince somebody who has a different answer that I am right in terms of atoms getting further away from each other and he or she is wrong? Ten more seconds. If by this time you still haven't voted and you don't know, make it a game. The Duke, press a button. Okay? So random button between 1 and 3. Maybe it again. There's no, nothing depends on it. Your salary will not be affected by it. There's no risk. Okay, now find the neighbor as a different answer and try to convince that person of your answer. And if necessary, walk around. Go ahead.
Thank you.
I'm sure that by now most of you have forgotten that I am not here to talk about metal plates with circuit boards. I'm here to talk about education. Imagine I've given my little lecture about thermal expansion like I just did, and then instead of asking you the question, I'd said, let's now apply this to rectangular metal plates with circular holes in it. If you take one of these plates and put it in the oven and turn up the temperature, the plate will expand and the diameter of the hole will... Even the people who are sitting at their computers are looking out now. You would have been sleeping through the whole thing because, I mean, what is more boring than rectangular metal plates with circular holes in them? Isn't it amazing? I beg your pardon?
Statistics is, according to my students.
Let me tell you, if you can do this, because in a sense, you know, it's the innate curiosity of the human mind, right? I mean, you want to understand, and I've shown you in a sense how easy it is to reawaken that curiosity of the human mind, and trust me, if you can do this with metal plates with circular holes in this, you can do it with statistics too. So, before I tell you the answer, let's sort of see what happens, you know. You thought about the question, and then I had you make a commitment without any other incentive, right? Just by satisfied curiosity of your mind, in a sense. And then you had to externalize your answer. You turn to somebody else and say, I chose answer, what did you choose? And something interesting happened, and even though I did not go into the audience as I usually do, I could see it from your gesticulation. You moved from the answer of the fact to the reasoning. It was no longer about it increases, decreases, they say no. It was, why does it increase? But the most important part, and this is in a sense what education is about, right? It's not just about the answer, it's about the process. We'll talk more about that when we talk about assessment, actually. But the most important thing is, you became emotionally invested in the learning. If I were to tell you now, oops, coffee break, I'm sorry, we'll stop here, you'd come running after me to ask me what the answer is. Now, before I can tell you the answer, you need to vote again. So please vote again. Indicate what you now believe to be the right answer. Even if you have not changed your mind, you know, in that case, you press the same button. But vote again. 10 more seconds. Even if you've not changed your answer, please vote again. Okay, 66. Well, I have some bad news for you. Only 25% of you got it right the first time around. You know, in a sense, you've been telling me something really important. Because you've said, Eric, your lecturing sucks. Which is actually exactly the point I wanted to make. I gave you a brief lecture. Well, really, you should have done your reading before coming. But you know, when it gets just to 25%, there's just not enough people. That means only 1 in 4 had the right answer, and usually it doesn't work that well. Of course, I chose the question specifically for that reason. The correct answer is, look at that. Everybody is looking at me. There's nobody texting, nobody. Computer screens are not being looked at. Okay, the right answer is, I need a drum roll here. The right answer is, drum roll. Even though it was only a quarter that it right, it still went up. And the most popular choice before, it gets smaller, went down. Now, I don't want you to lie in bed tonight at 2 a.m. awake because of this question. So let me take another few minutes of my precious time. Imagine you have a jar of jam in the refrigerator. It's one of these bowl jars, right? And it has a glass jar and a metal lid, which is a ring and a plate. You take it out of the fridge, you can't open it. What do? You run the metal lid under hot water. The ring expands, the hole gets larger. You say, you know, you didn't ask about a jar. Okay, let's imagine we take not a metal plate with a hole in it, but it's a metal plate without a hole in it. Here's the plate. We take a marker and we draw a big circle. We have a plate with a circle drawn on it. Now we put that plate in the oven and the plate expands. What happens to the diameter of the circle we've drawn on it? It gets larger. You say, that's unfair, there's no hole in it. If there was a hole, then the atoms would expand into the hole. I'll show you what's wrong with that statement. Imagine we all go outside, it's a beautiful day, and we form a big circle holding hands. That's us. We are the atoms at the edge of the hole. Each of us is an atom. Now we step in towards the center of the hole. What just happened to the distance between us? Got smaller. Can't get smaller because our neighbor needs more space, and we need more space too. The only way to get further away from each other would be to remove a few of us. But atoms don't disappear like that. Or to make the hole larger. You won't forget. Okay, back to, I'm gonna wrap up here. Back to peer instruction. I wish I could show you the data, but the first year that I implemented it, I doubled the gain on the SCI, and my students' exam performance went up. And the year after that, I tripled the learning gain by using better questions in class. And also, other people have shown in other fields that there's better retention. Better retention of what people have learned, and better retention of students in the disciplines that are taught. Let me end by briefly revisiting what happens in a lecture. In a lecture, as I said before, it's very hard to pay utmost attention. And we were talking about sleeping before. At MIT, at the Media Lab, in the Effective Computing Group, they developed a little sensor that you can wear around your wrist, like one of these fitness sensors. Except that it doesn't measure heart rate or skin temperature or motion. It measures electrodermal activity. And they show in this paper that they can use the electrodermal activity measured at the wrist as a proxy for brain activity. They subtract from it an emotion so that motor neuron firing in the wrist do not affect the data. And because of that, the time constant is much longer. So you cannot distinguish between alpha, beta, gamma, delta waves, but you can sort of see the overall brain activity. They use it for pain monitoring and other purposes. But in the paper where they show this sensor, what they show is one figure 9 or so, which is data collected by an MIT student during an entire week. The paper is not about education at all. It's about electrodermal monitoring. Here's that figure. And you can see the different days. Here, day 1, day 2, day 3 for the whole week. Starting at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, when the students started wearing it, to 3 o'clock the next day. And you can see there are periods of intense neural activity and periods of less neural activity. They also asked the student to keep track of what he or she was doing separately. I want to draw your attention to parts of the trace labeled class. The trace goes flat. Compare that to sleep, which is this highlighted region here. In other words, your students are more asleep in their classrooms than they are in their own beds. Now, don't look at the screen. Look at me, because the answer to my next question is on the screen. And I want you to think. There's one activity that matches class. What would that be?
Sleeping.
Not sleep, sleep is a watching TV. Exactly, here we go. And this is something that I've been known for a long time. Put people in front of the TV and they go into a meditative state. And the reason is the same. There might be emotional engagement, but there's no time to think because there's this information coming at you nonstop. You can't say, wait, I got to think. If you think, you're no longer listening and watching. Why would listening and watching a lecture be any different, either live or online, any different from watching TV? I think there's actually quite some repercussions for online learning too. So that's one. The other thing is, you think you know it. You thought you knew it about thermal expansion. You haven't had the time to really think about it and be confronted with any misconceptions, though. There was an experiment that was done at the University of Iowa, which is really interesting. It deals with calico cats, which are these cats that have this fur pattern. Now, the fur color in cats is encoded on the X chromosome. So to have this fur pattern, you need two X chromosomes. And therefore, almost all calico cats, 97% or so, are female. So they ask a biologist to record two short video lectures on the genetics of calico cats. They were identical in content. In one of the two, she spoke upright, confident, fluidly, without ever referring to her notes. In the other one, she was slumped over her notes, never looked straight into the camera, haltingly speaking. They took a large bio class, split it into two, had half of them watch the fluent video on the left, and the other half the disfluent video. After that, they asked students to predict how well they would do on a test of the genetics of calico cats. The students who had seen the fluent video predicted doing twice as well as those on the disfluent video. Then they distracted the students for 10 minutes and tested them. And you know what? They did the same. They did the same. There was no difference in how much students had learned. So it's all really an illusion. In part, it's because you've not been confronted with misconception. So the lecture creates this illusion that you know it, both with the instructor and with the students. But in the end, it's a false sense of security. So education is not just about transferring information. It's not just about students getting to know and do what we can do. Active participation is absolutely a must. And I've shown you how easy it is to reawaken the curiosity of the human mind, even with things that at face value are really not that exciting. If you want more information, you can join this social network of peer instruction users, where you can find other peer instruction users in your discipline or in your geographical area. Please return your clicker. They don't control your TV or microwave or anything, so maybe you can leave them on the, we won't need them for the second.